Hi, everybody. Welcome to Science Everywhere. We're so happy to have you with us today here at our usual time, 4 p.m. on Tuesdays on YouTube Live. Science Everywhere is a program of the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center, made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by the City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. We are talking about what's happening outside, the change in seasons, like today, right today. And what you'll just need a few simple supplies to do the activity today, and really it's something you'll do after our program. So you'll need some glue, some paper, pencil, a paintbrush would be handy, and some seeds. So guess what we are going to be talking about today? And did I show you the string?
String.
And you've probably noticed here we are together in the same place for the first time during Science Everywhere. So hi, Miss Mary, how are you today?
It's really fun to be actually in the same room together after doing Science Everywhere for more than a year. This is the first time we have done a program together. So that's actually pretty exciting. I'm also happy to be talking about fall. I love the season of fall, and I can't wait to share the fun crafts we're doing today. Just a little preview, we will be making acorn emoji necklaces. There you can see their little face. And we're going to be making seed mosaics and also some artwork with maple seed pods, helicopters, I call them. And we'll talk a little more about that later. But in the meantime, first a reminder, all available Queens Public Library locations are now open. You can enjoy unlimited browsing and seating at all our libraries that are available right now. And masks are required for everyone, including us. And as you know, it's back to school time. So you can visit queenslibrary.org to see all of our back to school programs and to read our guide with helpful tips on returning to in-person school, family communication, and more. Also, as you know, all year long, we've been celebrating the 125th anniversary of Queens Public Library. Again, you can visit queenslibrary.org for book lists, resources, and more on how you can share your QPL story. Also want to mention for the adults in the room, the next election takes place in November, and early voting starts on October 23rd. So visit voting.nyc to learn what is on the ballot and to stay informed. Make sure you are registered to vote, grown-ups. September 28th is National Voter Registration Day, and October 8th is the deadline to register. So registration forms will be available at your local library. So let's begin our program. Tomorrow is the first day of fall, which means that today is the last day of summer. So I want to start out right away by reading a book, a very appropriate book for this day. I'm gonna move so we can see this better. There we go. It's called Goodbye Summer, Hello Autumn, and it is by Kennard Park. And the publisher for this is Henry Holt and Company. It's a perfect book for today. Goodbye Summer, Hello Autumn. And it starts, it's a child talking to parts of nature. So there's two voices or several voices here. Hello, late summer morning. Hello, trees. And the trees say, hello. Now that the cool winds have come, we love how our branches sway in the sun. Hello, playful foxes and singing blue jays. They say, hello. We are busy looking for food. Some of us are heading south to our winter homes. Hello, Hello, walking stick and butterflies. Hello. We're surprised you saw us. We try our best to blend in, and we'll do the same in warmer places. Hello, beavers. Hello, chipmunks. Hello. We have no time to play because we're making cozy nests and dens. It'll be cold soon, and we want to get ready. Hello, flowers. Hello. We are leaning into the sun, enjoying the last summer rays. Some of us, like asters and phlox, are late bloomers. We make the end of the season seem even more colorful. This is a beautiful, colorful page. Hello, breezy wind. Hello. I love to whoosh, drizzle, and leaves through the misty streets. Hello, chill air. Hello. It's time to bring out your thick sweaters and scarves. Not quite yet, but pretty soon. Hello, leaves. Hello. We are changing our colors. Some of us turn red or brown, while others turn gold or yellow. The dogwood leaves turn purple. Another beautiful, colorful page. Hello, big orange sun. Hello, I am setting earlier and earlier now that summer is coming to an end. But I'll see you again tomorrow. And that's something I'm definitely noticing. It is getting darker earlier. Goodbye, summer. That makes me a little sad. It's a beautiful page. Hello, autumn. And that is the end. And I like to clap for a good story. Okay.
So, well, you know, one of the things it mentioned in the book is, you know, the some of the animals migrating, and some animals, particularly birds, do go to different parts of the world. Like in our part of the world, some of the birds fly south in the wintertime and come back in the summer. And we're going to be talking a little bit about the food they need and why some of them are able to stay here and some of them go away. And it mentioned flowers in the book. And
wait a minute until I get the chance to show this part.
Oh, yes.
That's going to say, it does mention flowers in the book, and I brought some flowers in to share with you, and I was showing Miss Lynn, too. Here are some flowers that are in my garden. These are cone flowers, also known as echinacea. Here's one. Here's another. And these are called black-eyed Susans, yellow flowers. Here is another one. I got these in my garden this weekend. I bet you noticed something about these flowers that we want to talk about today. Although in the book we mentioned some flowers that are blooming in the fall, asters are some, chrysanthemums. These flowers bloom in the summer, and look what's happening to them now. The beautiful parts, the colorful parts, maybe some part, the colorful parts are turning not so colorful, and they're falling off. In fact, I was hoping that they would even last this long so I could show you. They were almost all falling off. And they're getting brown, and they're not staying on the flower anymore. And instead, here, the center of the flower is getting dried out and spiky. And Miss Lynn, now can you share that book and tell everybody what those dry, spiky things are?
Yes. So I have a book for you today. And this book talks about what's been going on during, oh yes. And I should tell you what this book is. It's What's Inside a Flower? And the author is Rachel Ignatovsky, and I hope that I'm pronouncing her name correctly, or at least close to correctly. And this book has such beautiful illustrations. And over the summer, plants have been growing and blooming, making beautiful, colorful flowers. And in the middle of the flower is where the seeds start to form and grow and grow. And as the seeds are getting ripe, the petals fade and start to fall off, just like the flowers from Miss Mary's garden. And then the seeds continue to ripen, maybe even grow a little bit larger. And seeds come in all different kinds of packages. Like, have some of you eaten a seed carrier like this lately? This is one of the fruits that we grow lots of here in New York. And then over here is something that you might eat from time to time. These are peas or beans. And at the end of the summertime is when gardeners and farmers harvest the plants that they have been growing, like their apples, peaches, sunflower seeds, all kinds of wonderful food that helps keep us healthy. And then here are a lot of other seed containers. Some of those probably look familiar to you, like you might have eaten one like this sometime recently.
And Lynn, I have some actual seeds and their containers that I actually just collected over the past couple of days. And I'm wondering if people will recognize. Now, as Ms. Lynn said, my flowers that I brought in, those little spiky things on the top, those are seeds. And they get drier and drier, and eventually they fall off unless, well, we'll talk a little bit more about what else might happen to them. But there are other kinds of plants other than flowers that produce seeds. And I found some on my way to work the other day, and I'm going to show them to you. See, we'll have a little guessing game, and you can just answer the question out loud in your home. Or if you want, you could just say it in your head, and you can know if it's correct or not. You'll know when you're right. So here we go. Here's to start. These are seeds. And go right ahead and say in your head or out loud, what do we call those seeds? There's a name for them that most of us know. And I think if you said acorn, those are acorns, that you'd be right. So who knows what plant, what large plant produces these seeds? Give you a minute to think about it. We know, here's a hint. It's a kind of tree.
And it's an oak tree.
It's an oak tree. All right, next one. These I also found on my walk to work, walk to the train. I used to call these helicopters. Some people call them whirligigs, but they actually are the seeds and also a sort of little seed vehicle for another kind of tree. Does anyone know what kind of tree makes these helicopters?
Oh, those come from maple trees. I bet a lot of you have knew that.
Now, I just want to share with you that the seed part is in this little part here. And then I'm going to try to see if I can take it out. Maybe I'll take one that already is out. You can open up that part with your nails. Maybe not. There we go. And inside, if you are able to open it up, you will find the seed. And there we go. I got it there.
So I'm going to put it down there. This is the seed. You will see animals, birds, or squirrels sometimes eating those. And actually, sometimes people with these on their noses. They're sticky. So that's another seed container, another seed vehicle. And then, Miss Lynn, do you want to share some of the ones that you have right there? So here are some seeds that might look really familiar to you. Have you eaten any of these lately? Excuse me. I actually had some black beans and some corn in my lunch today. And how many of you have had these as a snack? Sunflower seeds. Oh, those are wonderful snacks.
Sometimes I have those as a snack too, especially around Halloween.
Yes.
Can anyone guess what those seeds are? You remember?
Here's
what
these come from.
You may see them inside their fruit, actually, around Halloween.
And we think of them as generally being quite big. Oh, an orange.
An orange. And they are pumpkin seeds. Oh, let's see. Those look like might look familiar to some people.
These are, this was is a red bean. There's lots of different kinds of beans and peas that make excellent food for people, but also.
And also, let's not forget these too, corn. This is a dried kind of corn that you can, animals will eat, and actually people too. And that's one thing I wanted to talk about, Lynn, because, well, first of all, you mentioned that seeds are make new plants, but there's some extras, right? There's extra seeds. Not every seed becomes a new plant, right?
Yeah, plants usually make lots and lots of seeds, way more than are really going to become new plants. And it's one of the wonders of nature that the plants and the animals seem to work together really well. Seeds are wonderful little energy packets to grow new plants, but they also are nutritious, energy-giving food for animals. Sometimes creatures like us, but lots of other animals eat seeds, and there's a special science name for those. They're called granivores.
So I was telling Miss Lynn that I actually got the idea of having this program because I saw a bird sitting on, maybe not this one, but one looking very much like this in my garden. And it was picking out as many of these little seeds as it could. So I realized, I thought to myself, wow, we think of flowers as just looking beautiful in our garden, but flowers were lunch for that little guy. And then I realized that some food is lunch, some seeds are food for us too, like the sunflowers, like the beans, walnuts. Oh, I forgot to share one, Miss Lynn, that I really want to because it's so
cool. Yes, I
really
like that one.
Me too, because I did not know what this was. I found this on my way to work, and it looks, starts out looking sort of like this, and then it gets a little darker, and then it sort of cracks along the sides, and you can see that there is the seed inside there, sort of like a nut, right?
Well, it is a nut. And as a matter of fact, the actual seed part is inside this very hard coating. Boy, are these seeds well protected. And does anyone have a guess what this is? It's from a large tree.
I did not know this one either.
And this is a hickory nut from a hickory tree.
Which I just thought was so cool. And so we got to thinking about, well, birds eat seeds and we eat seeds. We realized actually quite a few animals in our city, in New York City, and also our state, eat seeds. So we thought we'd show you some pictures. See, right now, why don't you just say a couple things out loud. Think what kind of animal that you might see eats seeds.
Ooh, I can think of one that has a big bushy tail.
Ooh, right. So we have a slideshow now that we want to share with you that has some pictures of some of the animals that you might see. Which I think, here we go. Can we see that?
Can you see our slideshow?
Let me skip for a second. No.
Okay. I thought he was going to share it. Okay, give us half a second here. There we go. Thank you for your patience. Oh, these are birds. And have you seen any of these in your neighborhood or at the park or maybe when you were out hiking somewhere?
One of the birds is actually the bird that I, same kind of bird that I saw. Eating the flowers in my garden. That is a goldfinch.
They are beautiful. And they kind of match these black-eyed Susans. I've often seen them on black-eyed Susans. And I bet you recognize this bright red bird, cardinal. And what is this one, Miss Mary?
I think it's called a chickadee, but I think it has a longer name than that, too.
Oh, a black-capped chickadee, because it has this, like a dark feathers on its head that looks like a cap.
Should we check to just make sure? Yep, okay.
And then this is a finch, another kind of finch. These are both finches. And who knows what these are? I bet a lot of you have seen these. Can you call it out? Sir, white-tailed deer.
I think we might want to go back. I think we might have missed some too.
Oh, it seems like.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah. There.
And
our friend, the bushy-tailed squirrel.
So the squirrels are probably what most people think about when they think about animals gathering nuts and seeds for the winter, but there are actually more animals out there that are doing the exact same thing. Like for example, on our next slide, we have chipmunks and also mice, field mice, outdoor mice.
Yeah, which is where I think mice should be, is outdoors, gathering seeds to eat because they make such good food. And this chipmunk has been gathering seeds and its cheeks are full of seeds.
We have the birds.
Back to our bird friends, the deer, and who knows what this animal is? Hopefully one you won't see here in New York City.
I don't think we have black bears in New York City. We do not. But black bears do live in our state and actually not that far away from us. And the funny thing is that even though they're such big animals, you don't think about them eating things like seeds and nuts, but in fact, they do. They eat seeds and nuts and berries, as well as other things. But as Miss Lynn said, nuts are very nutritious food. And so lots of animals depend on them to live, especially animals that stay around here in the wintertime.
Oh, yes. And I'm going to go back to our bird for just a second. Birds that leave us in this time of year and migrate to the south are mostly insect eaters. And as you know, the insects can't live in the wintertime here. So insect eaters have to leave, but the granivores, the seed-eating birds, stick around because there are seeds to be found in the woods, in the parks, all around. And then we have one more, and this might be kind of surprising to you, bugs that eat seeds. And I love this bug. I just think they're so cool looking. This is an acorn weevil, and they have this crazy long snout. And the mom weevil lays her eggs on acorns when the acorns are small, and the little caterpillar-like larvae burrow into the acorn, and there they are, safe and snug and secure with lots of nutritious food to eat. And when they are grown up and ready to become adults, they eat their way out of the acorn, and you might find an acorn with a hole in it like that. And these guys are harvester ants, and they collect seeds and put them in their nests so that they are well provisioned throughout the year.
Okay.
And we're going to stop sharing now.
Okay. So now we're going to talk a little bit about what kind of art or creative projects we can do with seeds that we find in nature. So I'm going to give you some ideas of what you can do with the seeds and other natural things that you find, say when you're walking around your neighborhood over the next few days. So I'm going to show, I'm going to put this down like this. So when you're walking around the neighborhood, you might find, for example, some acorns. And as I mentioned earlier, acorns are really fun because you can draw on them. And I decided to make them into little faces. They look like little people with hats. And so I decided to make what I call acorn emojis. This one is this brownie face, as you see. And this one is a surprise face, as you can see. And this one is a happy face. And you can also make them into little necklaces just by tying some string around them or some twine. So in order to make your little emoji, you're just gonna use a Sharpie and you're just gonna draw a little face. I can't draw faces upside down, so I'm gonna make one. Oh, I can see it. I'm going to make a sleepy acorn emoji. And then if we wanted to make it so that we could wear it around our necks as a necklace, all you do is you cut a piece of string or twine. And it's a little bit tricky. You make a knot in it, almost like you were going to tie a knot like that. And then you slide your little guy right in, almost as if he's wearing a headband. Now that is not going to stay very well unless you add the extra touch, which is a big glob of glue right where the knot is. And I am not going to move it after that. I'm just going to put that big glob there, and I'm going to put it down over here. And when it dries, it will be secure, much like this one is here. So acorns, you could do a lot of fun things with acorns. You could also use tempera paint or just permanent markers to make them different colors. And you can make whatever designs you want. You can make little animals, faces. You can make a little fruit. You can make them look like strawberries or just do designs, whatever your imagination tells you. Now, another thing that's really fun to work with is the maple leaf seed helicopters. Miss Lynn, what have we learned that they're called?
Well, the botanical name for this kind of seed is a samara.
Samara. So I think the cool thing about the samaras is that they are like little wings. And so it's fun to use them as sort of a collage to add wings to something that you draw. I'm going to move this out of the way. So I drew this dragonfly, sort of a fat dragonfly. And I realized that the wings of a dragonfly are very, very similar looking to the maple seed wings. I colored mine in with some permanent marker. I did not try to do a authentic looking dragonfly, but dragonflies are blue.
You did a very good job.
Thank you. And now let's do another one. So I'm going to make one the other way because it's easier for me. So a dragonfly has sort of a head that's a little bit like a half circle. And then it has a part of the body that I believe is called the thorax. Is that right?
That's correct.
And then it has a part that I thought was a tail, but Miss Lynn tells me is actually
the abdomen.
The abdomen. And this one, now I know, happen to know that I do think that some dragonflies are orange. So this guy is going to be orange.
They do come in a lot of bright, really beautiful colors.
A lot of times, I have to admit, their wings are clear, but not these guys. And then I decorated these samaras. This one has striped. There is a dragonfly that has orange and black wings. So then you're going to break it in half, and you're going to get some glue. Excellent. We'll just put two big globs, one on either side. Here we go, squeeze. There we go. And there's one. And we'll need a little more for the next because they have double wings.
They do have two sets of wings.
Pair of wings.
Yeah.
And now you can use Elmer's glue, any kind of school glue. This is tacky glue, which is a craft glue, which actually it's very nice if you have it where it's a little bit stronger. But since this is just a decoration, it doesn't have to be super strong. There you go. And you could use these wings for other things too. Maybe you'd want to have a butterfly or a bird or something completely different. So again, this is just a way of using your imagination to use some natural materials. And the last thing I want to tell you, let's see, we have one more minute left maybe, is that you can use seeds to make a beautiful mosaic. Now you can draw a picture that you want to fill in with your seeds, or I actually printed out this flower shape. And then you can use glue to glue down your seeds to fill in your picture. Now you can put the seeds in one by one. And I did that around the edge here. I wanted to have a perfectly nice row of sunflower seeds. But then after that, you can just fill in a part of your flower. And you can actually use your brush to swish it around a little bit. And then you can just sprinkle your seeds. And you're going to end up filling up this whole flower or whatever you decide to use. And it will end up being a beautiful mosaic that you could actually just enjoy as a fall decoration. Or as Miss Lynn pointed out, you could actually put it outside and see if the birds in your neighborhood would like to eat it. So again, those are just some ideas of what you can do with the nature that you find as you walk around the neighborhood. And I think that's bringing us very close to the end of our program. So before we say goodbye, we just want to share our handout, which we will call up right now.
And so, like usual, it's got some of the books, and our next Science Everywhere with Miss Mary and I on October 19th. And then on the back, we have a little nature journal for you. And we hope that you'll be able to either see outside your window or take walks in your neighborhood, the park, or maybe even on a hike. And if you see any of these granivores, you just mark them off when you find them. You might even want to make a little note about them. And then we also want to note that our friends Dazzling Discoveries are going to be doing Science Everywhere programs on October 5th and October 26th, same time, 4 p.m. YouTube Live. And you can scan this QR code to watch that. And you also can set a reminder for yourself.
And there are going to be grab-and-go kits available related to those programs at both Hunter's Point Library and Massabeth Community Library. And the addresses are on that handout.
They are.
And so I think that's it for today.
Yeah. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone, and have a happy fall.
Yeah. Enjoy this beautiful fall weather. Bye-bye.
Bye.